What if the ancient secrets of pottery could come full circle right here in your backyard? I'm Will from Willow's Southwest Studio, and in this episode of Secrets of the Sanaa, we're taking our next step in this journey. Last time, we crafted a beautiful olla using the traditional paddle and anvil technique. Today, it's time to bring that pot to life with the primitive outdoor firing. Join me on this adventure today, and we'll uncover the ancient mysteries of fire, clay, and technique. Let's get started. Before any great discovery can happen, preparation is key. This shallow pit, just 4 to 5 inches deep, will become the heart of today's experiment. A place where ancient techniques meet modern curiosity. I'm going to use my shovel here, along with some instinct. I start to shape a pit, smoothing and stamping it with care. Every detail matters in recreating the methods of the past. It's simple, but simplicity often holds the greatest secrets. With the final check, it's ready. And here it is, the olla we crafted in the last episode, now ready for its trial by fire. Oh boy, guys, and here we have Saladia. Oh, she's going back in for a refiring. She came out kind of filthy. I'm gonna set my olla right on this cover shirt here because we're gonna be warming this up by the warm-up fire that we're about to get going. We'll just let it sit here nice and happy. Get ready to get some wood for this. But before this pot can truly take on its ancient identity, it must endure the flames. Let's prepare the warm-up fire with a few pieces of scrap lumber to set the stage. And I got my trusty Sinagua peace pipe starter here. We're just gonna start this warm-up fire like so. Oh boy. Well, after multiple attempts, come on, my friend, come on. Oh, there we go. Oh, whew. Had me a little worried there. And we got the fire started now. Oh, just beautiful. Look at this. Whew, didn't think that was gonna start at first. The warm-up fire is critical. It gently prepares the clay. Slowly, I'm going to rotate the pot, giving every inch a chance to acclimate. The fire crackles and glows, a reminder of the balance between nature's raw power and the precision required for this process. Oh boy, the flames are nearly burnt out, signaling it's time for the next step, the pottery furniture setup. This step might look simple, but it's one of the most important parts of the firing process. These clay bricks, known as pottery furniture, elevate the pot above the coals. This elevation allows proper airflow, ensuring the fire burns clean and hot, oxidizing the clay and burning away carbon evenly. Without this step, the firing would be uneven, and the pot would suffer from discoloration or a lot of carbon. The Sinagua most likely use some rocks to elevate their pottery in their firing process. This is a delicate step. The pot is carefully placed onto the pottery furniture, ensuring it's steady and centered. If it hasn't been warmed up evenly, the sudden heat from the coals below could cause cracks. It's a tense moment, but with care, the pot is now ready for the next stage of the firing process. Finally, I place a cover shirt over the pot. This isn't an essential step, but it protects the interior from ash or coal, ensuring the finished piece remains clean and functional. Sometimes, even with ancient techniques, it's good to call in some modern advice. I'm going to call up Red Paw and ask for his recommendation on the best wood for this firing. Hey Red Paw, I'm about to start this pottery firing, and I wanted your take. What's the best wood to use for fuel?
Juniper would be my pick. It burns hot and clean, which is perfect for this type of firing.
Juniper, huh? That sounds like a great option. I'll give it a try.
Sounds good. Let me know how it works out for you. I'm curious to see the results.
Will do. Thanks for the advice, Red Paw. Here it is, juniper wood, known for its clean, hot burn. It's a perfect choice for this firing. The ancient Sinagua most likely used cottonwood or juniper for their firings. They understood the importance of selecting the right fuel to ensure their pottery survived the flames. As I carefully stack the juniper around the pot, I can't help but think about the ingenuity of the Sinagua people. They lived in a rugged landscape and relied on their deep knowledge of natural materials to thrive. Their pottery wasn't just functional, it was a testament to their resourcefulness and skill. Each step in this process, from clay preparation to the fire itself, connects us to their incredible legacy. For this firing, I've actually double stacked my wood. I have an inner layer with wood stacked in a teepee form, and then I've stacked a second layer of wood around it, so I've got plenty of fuel for this fire. With the stack complete, it's time to step back and take it in. This is the critical moment where preparation meets anticipation. I'm feeling pretty confident this is gonna work. Now for the moment we've all been waiting for, the main event begins. With a single spark, the fire is lit, a process as ancient as it is mesmerizing. As the flames grow, they'll transform this stack of wood and clay into something timeless. The fire is alive now, and the journey is underway. All we can do now is wait and watch as this little fire begins to grow. The fire is fighting to catch. It's puffing out a lot of smoke, struggling to fully ignite, but the flames are starting to grow. Slowly but surely, the transformation has begun. Oh boy, this is the moment where patience meets anticipation. The fire is finding its rhythm, and soon it'll roar to life with beauty. Oh boy, the top of the fire is now fully combusted, working its way down into the stack. It sure is a powerful sight, but this is just the beginning. It is giving off some crazy heat right now. The fire grows larger with every passing second, feeding on the juniper and releasing waves of intense heat. It is an inferno now, a blazing testament to the raw power of this process. Wow, this is incredible. Oh my goodness, the heat is almost unbearable now, radiating like a furnace. It's time to take some temperature readings, just to see how far this fire is pushing the limits. Whoa guys, already the fire has reached the low 800 C's. This is incredible, and it is still climbing. The heat is absolutely incredible. It's as if the wind is feeding the flames, pushing them even higher. Oh my goodness, the temperature is still climbing. We are at 892 C now, and it is still quickly rising. Oh boy. These wind gusts are adding fuel to the fire, pushing it far beyond its usual limits of a normal firing. This is absolutely new territory to me, and the heat just keeps building. Wow. 920 C, and the fire is not slowing down. Oh my goodness, this is just incredible. We are far beyond the usual firing range now, and the heat is just staggering. Wow, 987 C, that is the highest temperature I have ever reached in any firing. Oh my goodness, the intensity is beyond anything I've ever experienced before. Even from a distance, the heat is just overwhelming. Wow, I can just feel it through the air as I take another reading. This fire is like nothing I've ever seen, blazing hotter and brighter than ever. Wow, have I pushed it too far? Did the pot survive this extreme trial? Only time will tell. For now, all I can do is hope. The waiting game begins. With the fire burning out and starting to cool down, all I can do now is reflect and hope that the pot has survived this intense firing. The fire is finally out, leaving behind a bed of ash and a hidden story. Beneath it lies the olla, waiting to reveal whether it has endured or has been lost to the flames. Uh-oh, something's not right. I wasn't expecting this. Look at these strange blisters that have formed on the clay body. This is unexpected and a bit concerning. I've never seen anything like this before. But on the other side, there is beauty. Just check out these amazing fire clouds. Are these awesome or what? Oh wow, this is just awesome. Well, I'm gonna call up Red Paw and let him know the results. Hey Red Paw, I've got some results for the firing. We had some absolute crazy gusts of wind that fueled this fire, causing it to heat up way beyond what I had planned. We hit 987 C. The pot survived, but there's these really strange blisters on the clay body.
Yeah, that sounds like it was caused by the high temperatures. It could be due to the iron in the clay body reacting to the extreme heat.
Oh wow, that's interesting.
Honestly, I'm glad the jar survived it all under those conditions. Wild clay can be unpredictable, especially with temperatures that high.
Thanks, Red Paw. I'm about to pull it out of the ashes right now.
Good luck, and I hope the next firing goes a lot smoother. You have a good one, Will.
Here it is, fresh from the ashes. The cover shirred over the lid. It's seen quite a few firings, but wow, look at this. The heat was just too much. It's cracked. And look at all these micro cracks running through it. This is incredible. Oh wow, it must have really got hot. And here's the pot itself. The blisters seem to be isolated on this side, a reminder of how extreme this firing was. But just look at the other side. Are these fire clouds incredible or what? Oh, this is just beautiful. Oh boy, but not all is perfect. There is a large crack here at the bottom. Still, despite the flaws, it held together. Listen to this beautiful ding. Wow, this has one crazy high-pitched ding. This firing was full of surprises, extreme temperatures, beautiful fire clouds, and a pot that held on through it all. It's a testament to the unpredictability and beauty of primitive pottery. But this journey isn't over yet. Next up, I'll be creating a traditional water pitcher, pushing these techniques even further. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to give it a like, leave a comment, and subscribe to Willow's Southwest Studio so you don't miss what's coming next.
Wow, was that crazy or what? Alright my friends, once again, thanks so much for watching, and I hope to see you in the next episode. Till next time.